Hello children, welcome to today's class. Children, today we are going to learn the lesson The Northern Plains. So in the previous classes itself we have learned about what is mean by plain, how a plain will be and what is the difference between a mountain and a plain, isn't it? So especially we have learned about the Northern Plains and we have seen about the extension of the Northern Plains, where it starts and what kind of a thing will be formed in the Northern Plains, and we have learnt about the formation of the Northern Plains. So along with it we have learnt about the main soil, that is alluvial soil, and what are all the characteristics and what are all the basins which has been formed in the Northern Plains. So by continuation of that, in this part 2 we are going to learn the following contents. So what are all the contents? Introduction, the Indus or the Satluj Basin, Tarai and the Ganga Basin. So these are all the topics which we are going to learn in detail today. So first we are going to learn about the Indus or the Satluj Basin. So children, already we have learned in the previous session what is a basin, isn't it? Basin is nothing but an area which is being continuously watered by a river or its tributaries. So this kind of an area we call it as a basin. For example, see in the backdrop I have given mountains, in between running flowing water is there, isn't it? So this is a kind of a basin. It is a picture of a basin. So this kind of an area which is being watered continuously by a river or its tributary is called as a basin. So here we are going to learn about the Indus or the Satluj Basin. So first of all, let us see where does the Indus Basin starts to originate in the sense which is the starting point of the Indus. So the Indus gets started, that is it gets originates from a glacier in the Tibet. We also know what is a glacier, isn't it? When the snow melts into a water, that is called as a glacier. So the Indus Basin originates from a glacier which is being located in the Tibet. Second thing is, it enters India through Jammu and Kashmir. So it has its entry path to India through the Jammu and Kashmir. As river Indus flows through a small part of India, its longest tributary, river Satluj, forms a large basin in the Northern Plains. So when it started to enter India, it started to have its longest tributary's path, river Satluj, to form a largest basin in the Northern Plains. So we can able to get the information that river Satluj is the longest tributary which has been located in the Northern Plain area. And the river Bees is Satluj main tributaries. So there are many tributaries from the Satluj, and river Bees is the main tributary of the Satluj. And the next is, the river enters India through the Shipkila Pass. So the river enters through the Shipkila Pass. Already I told you what is mean by a pass, isn't it? Pass is nothing but a way which connects from one mountain to the other mountain, or it acts like a route to pass through from one mountain to the another mountain, isn't it? So through this way in India, it passes through the Shipkila Pass and it starts to flow through two states. One is Punjab and the other is the Haryana. So the river starts to enter through a pass named as Shipkila Pass, and after flowing through the Shipkila Pass, it starts to flow in two states. One is Punjab and the another one is Haryana. So these are the two states which are well known for their agriculture production. Why? In the sense, while this continuous flow of water is there, and because of the soil fertility, obviously the agriculture production is very much good in these kind of areas. So only Punjab and Haryana can able to cultivate more crops and can give a good quality and quantity amount of food products. So we can see what are all the crops which has been grown there. First is wheat, rice, cotton, sugarcane, millets and maize. So I have given you below the pictures of corn here, rice corn, and cotton field. This is a cotton field, and the third picture is the sugarcane field. So once again we will see what are all the crops: wheat crops, rice, cotton, sugarcane, millets and maize. Already we know the information that Punjab is being very much known for the good quality wheat, isn't it? We are using a very good quality of wheat from Punjab. So these are all the main crops which has been cultivated in Punjab and Haryana according to their climate and their soil fertility. So the next we are going to learn about the Tarai region. So what is the Tarai region? So see here at the backdrop I have given you a region of the Tarai only. Tarai region consists of swampy and marshy land that lies near the lower ranges of the outer Himalayas. So let us see first where the Tarai is being located. Tarai is being located near to the lowest ranges. Lowest ranges in the sense wherever the mountain is very very shorter in range, those things nearby the outer Himalayas, these Tarai regions has been located. And generally the Tarai region will be consist of swampy and marshy land. What is mean by swampy and marshy land? See the land in between, here and there water will be there and trees will be grown in between them. So these kind of stagnated watery land is called as a swampy and marshy land. And we can see the extension, it stretches from River Yamuna in the north side and River Brahmaputra in the east. So from north and east it has been stretched. Its starting from point is from the River Yamuna in the north and River Brahmaputra in the east. On its northern side there are springs and streams like River Ghagra that makes the area marshy. So many streams has been flowing there, like we have given an example like River Ghagra, that makes the area marshy, that is that keeps the area always watery. In this manner it will be always here and there filled up with water and wood trees. And the next is, on the other side there is a region of the gravel which is mostly covered by the salt forest. See the backdrop, I have given you a sandy structure and here and there trees has been completely grown up, isn't it? So these are all the salt forest which is being covered by sands like gravels, and it is being obviously covered entirely with the different kinds of trees, and especially it will be having most of the covering with the salt forest. And in the West Bengal and in Bangladesh, these areas is called as the dwars. So these kind of areas will be called as dwars in the area of West Bengal and Bangladesh. So the next we are going to learn about the Ganga basin. So already we have been learned first about which basin, Indus or the Satluj basin, isn't it? So remember, this is the second basin which we are going to learn, that is the Ganga basin. So the tributaries of the Ganga river, tributaries in the sense many branches. For example, river Ganga is the main river. From that river multiple branches of water will be flowing through that river, and these multiple branches are called as the tributaries, small branches, and this is called as a tributaries. So the tributaries of the river Ganga includes Gandak, Gomti, Ghagra, Kosi and Chambal. So once again I repeat the five tributaries of the Ganga. The tributaries of the river Ganga includes Gandak, Gomti, Ghagra, Kosi and Chambal that runs through the Ganga basin. So already we have learnt in the first part that northern plains has been watered by three basins. One is Ganga basin. So from that Ganga basin these rivers are being continuously, these tributaries has been run through. And the second thing is, the basin spreads mainly across the states of Uttar Pradesh, Bihar and West Bengal. So this basin doesn't stop between one point. It started to spread across three states. One is Uttar Pradesh and the second one is Bihar and the final is West Bengal. So these are the three states which has been completely spreaded by the Ganga basin. And the last is, as this basin is very fertile, it is also known as the food bowl of India. So here I have shown you a paddy field which has been located in the Uttar Pradesh area. So the agriculture land has been very very fertile. From the picture we can able to see the fertility of the
land, isn't it? Because of the fertility only, these kind of plenty amount of things can be grown. So it shows that the soil has been very, very fertile. So basis of this strength of the soil and fertility of the soil, the other name for the Ganga Basin is the food bowl of India. So what is the other name for the Ganga Basin? Ganga Basin is also known as the food bowl of India. So we are going to see what are all the crops which can be grown in this basin. So the first is the sugarcane. Sugarcane already we know that. Sugarcane, rice we know it, and jute, wheat and millets. Many grains can be grown here. So these are all the popular crops which can be seen in many areas of the basin. So what are all the crops? Sugarcane, rice, jute, wheat and millets. So major industries, whenever there is a crops, there will be automatically a development of the industries and factories. So we can see many major industries has been located in these three areas, Uttar Pradesh and West Bengal. So major industries like sugar mills, cotton textiles, fishery and power generation. So cotton textiles, in the sense previously we have seen that cotton can be easily cultivated there, isn't it? So depending upon the cotton, cotton textiles has been started. So depending upon the sugarcane product, sugar mills is there, and when there is a continuous flow of the Ganga Basin, we can able to get more fishery items and we can generate more power. So depending upon these things, major, that is many factories has been started in these areas. So what are all the major industries? Sugar mills, cotton textiles, fishery and power generation are found here. So next we are going to see about the Sundarbans forest. So before flowing into the Bay of Bengal, as we all know that Bay of Bengal, before flowing these tributaries getting mixed with the Bay of Bengal, the river Ganga along with the river Brahmaputra forms the largest delta in the world, the Ganga Brahmaputra Delta. So once again I repeat, before the Ganga Basin starts to flow through all the states and finally where it will be reaching, it will be reaching Bay of Bengal. So before reaching the Bay of Bengal, the river Ganga, it starts to mix up with the river Brahmaputra and it forms the largest delta, that is the largest watery area in the world. It is named as the Ganga Brahmaputra Delta. So once again I repeat the name, the delta name is the Ganga Brahmaputra Delta. And the Sundarbans are the marshy swamps of mangrove forest found in the lower parts of the delta. So nearby the Ganga Brahmaputra Delta, in its lower parts we can see many marshy swamps. Marshy swamps, already I told you, in and there water substances will be there. So in between, lands and trees will be there. So this is a kind of a mangrove forest. This has been called as a Sundarbans and it has been completely covered up with the mangrove forest. So once again children, we can recap whatever the things we have seen today. So first we have started with the origination of the Indus, isn't it? So Indus, where it originates? It originates from a glacier in Tibet and it starts to enter India, isn't it? So it enters India through which path? Jammu and Kashmir. Yes. So Indus River, what is the main tributary of the river Indus or the river Satluj? It is River Bees. So next we have seen through which it has been passed, isn't it? So the River Bees has been started to flow through the Shipkila Pass and this Shipkila has been spread through two states. One is Punjab and the other one is Haryana. Yes. And the next we have seen about the Tarai region. Tarai region, as I told you, it will be always consist of swampy and marshy land and will be located nearby the ranges of the outer Himalayas. And the second thing we have seen about the extension of the Tarai region, it starts to stretches from River Yamuna in the north and River Brahmaputra in the east. And finally we have seen in its northern side there is a River Ghagra. And the next we have seen about the Dwas. Dwas is nothing but a gravel region which is being given the name of Dwars in the West Bengal and the Bangladesh area. And next we have seen about the Ganga Basin. First we have started to segregate Ganga Basin into 5 tributaries and we have named those tributaries as Gandak, Gomati, Ghagra, Kosi and Chambal. And all these 5 tributaries will be flowing in the Ganga Basin. So this is the first part we have seen. And the second we have seen about the extension of the Ganga Basin. And it starts to spreads across 3 states. One is Uttar Pradesh, Bihar and West Bengal. And because of based of the soil fertility and the water flowing, this basin has been very very fertile. And because of this fertile quantity, it has been known as the food bowl of India. So Ganga Basin is otherwise called as the food bowl of India. So we have seen the popular crops grown here: sugarcane, rice, jute, wheat and millets. And we have seen about the major industries like sugar mills, cotton textiles, fishery and power generation. So depending upon the crops which has been grown here, industries has been started. So the next we have been seen, where does the Ganga Basin has been finally flown through? So Ganga Basin, before joining to the Bay of Bengal, it start to mix up with the river Brahmaputra and it forms the largest delta in the world. So remember it, it forms the largest delta in the world. The delta is named as Ganga Brahmaputra Delta. So the Sundarbans or the marshy swamps of mangrove forest which is being formed nearby the lower parts of the Ganga Brahmaputra Delta. So I have shown you the picture of the Sundarban forest also. So especially the Sundarban forest is being covered with the marshy swamps of mangrove forest. So children, I hope you that you are clear about the Indus and the Ganga Basin, isn't it? So now we are going to try a few questions from this portion. So the first is the Indus originates from a glacier in dash. You have to answer from which part the glacier has been started. The Indus originates from a glacier in dash. You can take your note and try out the answers, children. So the answer is yes, Tibet. Very good. So the next is, the Indus enters in India through dash. We have learned through a particular pathway it starts to enter India, isn't it? So which state you have to mention there? Again I repeat, the Indus enters in India through dash. So your answer is yes, Jammu and Kashmir. Very good. So third one is, Terai region consists of dash and dash region. So we have seen the Terai region will be consist of two regions. So you have to mention what are all the two regions. So what are the two regions? Marshy and swampy. Yes, very good. So next is, the largest delta in the world is the dash. We have seen only one largest delta which is being formed by the mixture of Ganga Basin and the Brahmaputra Basin, isn't it? Yes. How the basin will be called? The answer is Ganga Brahmaputra Delta. Very good, children. I hope that all your answers are right, isn't it? So kindly recap those places and those names as it will be new to you. You can read it and revise it. So thank you, children, for this session. Thank you.